Good morning and welcome to today's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know. I'm Steve Heminger, Executive Director of the Bay Area's Metropolitan Transportation Commission and your chair for today's program. You can find the Commonwealth Club on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. As you've heard already, this program is being held in association with several organizations, the American Association of State Highway and Transportation Officials, the American Planning Association of Northern California, the American Public Transportation Association, American Society of Civil Engineers, and my own agency, the Metropolitan Transportation Commission. I have the distinct personal pleasure of introducing today's keynote speaker, Policy Trottenberg. And I will note, those of you on the radio can't quite see this, but we are standing on the Barbara Boxer stool here, which Polly, in addition to her many other duties, once worked for Senator Boxer, so she's well aware of that, and I didn't realize she still traveled with it. Polly is currently the Assistant Secretary for Transportation Policy at the U.S. Department of Transportation. She was previously executive director of an organization called Building America's Future, a nonprofit created by former Pennsylvania Governor Ed Rendell, former California Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger, and current New York Mayor Michael Bloomberg to promote infrastructure investment around the country. Polly also worked in the United States Senate for 12 years for three pretty challenging bosses, Senator Boxer, who is our senator here in California and holds the key role of chairing the Senate Environment and Public Works Committee, the committee that will help write the next transportation law. Polly also worked for two New York senators, stern taskmasters themselves, Charles Schumer and Pat Moynahan, who was really a legend in our business and helped write the groundbreaking ICE-T law that Congress passed in 1991. Polly has worked extensively, not just on transportation issues per se, but on public works, on energy, on all the environmental issues that relate to this subject area. Prior to starting her career on Capitol Hill, Polly worked at the Port Authority of New York and New Jersey, the Massachusetts State Senate, and the Massachusetts Port Authority. All of that, and she's only 23 years old. Polly received her undergraduate degree from Barnard and her master's in public policy from the Kennedy School at Harvard University. I have known Polly for many years. She is kind, she is thoughtful, she is funny. Very unusual qualities in an official that our California ancestors would call a federale. So please join me in welcoming my favorite federale, Polly Trottenberg.
Thank you, Steve. It is true that I used to work for Senator Boxer, and I observed that she had the famous Boxer box, and I got to admit, I thought it was a little funny. When I took this job as Assistant Secretary, I find that I do a lot of traveling and a lot of speaking, and I have become a connoisseur of podiums. And I realized at 5'2", the box really makes sense. This is the largest podium I have ever seen. Speaking of upgrading infrastructure, maybe the Commonwealth Club could spring for a sleeker model. I don't know, just for the short people in the world. Anyways, thank you, Steve. Thank you, Ron, for this wonderful introduction. And thank you both for your leadership here. Steve, you are so well known both in the Bay Area and, of course, in Washington with your work on the commission. You have a very big fan club at USDOT. And I also want to thank the Commonwealth Club and the Mineta Transportation Institute for inviting me to participate today on behalf of the Obama administration and Transportation Secretary Ray LaHood. This is a very important summit on a very important topic. It's a topic that needs more public engagement and debate, and I'm glad to see the audience here, and I definitely look forward to your questions. Steve has discussed the challenge in my job. I have actually been doing a tour of the nation's transit systems this summer, New York, Boston, Chicago, DC, out here in San Francisco, and the needs are tremendous, absolutely tremendous. The challenge of reforming and funding our federal transportation system is something that really consumes my day at DOT. I don't have an easy job, but I do have an exciting one, and I think this is the fundamental challenge facing our nation right now. You know, as Mike was saying, we owe it to future generations of Americans. I'm going to move this gavel here. to provide them with a transportation system that is as remarkable and productive as the one that our parents and grandparents left us, the greatest generation, they did leave it for us. We need to make major investments, as you've heard on the panel this morning, in roads, bridges, rails, and ports. We need to create jobs, to be economically competitiveness, to provide safe and reliable transportation for our citizens, for our businesses, for our communities. It is something that is both urgent and immediate. Unfortunately, as you heard this morning, the fiscal and political consensus on how to do it is not. You know, as Steve mentioned, I got to work for two New York senators, and then I got to come work for Senator Barbara Boxer. And one of the major perks was of the job was that I got to travel all over California, which was terrific. And I got to learn firsthand about really the visionary side of this state, tackling climate change and smart growth, expanding your transit systems, and now laying the groundwork for high-speed rail. You know, in a lot of ways, California has always been a model and a leader for what the rest of the country. But I also got to see about a lot of the challenges you're facing in California right now, the housing market crash, high unemployment, the budget fights and the political dysfunction in Sacramento, the increasing indebtedness here, and obviously, as you're talking about, the decline in the physical infrastructure here, which is what made this state so great. So, you know, coming to the Boxer job with the New York perspective, I was also really, really impressed with the vision and the creativity of a lot of the California transportation leaders. Again, their leadership is well known nationally. And the willingness you have here, the counties, the 18 counties that tax themselves and have gotten super majorities to do it, it's extraordinary. There's really nothing like it in the rest of the country. And I agree with Steve, and we have really tried at USDOT to reward California for that. It's no coincidence that California has done so well in terms of high-speed rail money, in terms of Tiger money, which I'll talk about a little bit. It is in part because the state has come up with its own funding resources, and that is going to be incredibly important as we move forward. The panel you all heard has laid out the fiscal dilemma we face at the federal level. The federal gas tax has not been raised in 18 years. It's not adequate to cover our existing needs, let alone the things we need to do in the future. We have, in the past few years, added $35 billion of just general taxpayer funds to pay for highways and transit, and another $36 billion through the Economic Recovery Act. We can't continue that, and yet we face a profound political stalemate about how to move forward. And I think it turns out that having a highway trust fund, you know, it's turned out to be a mixed blessing. For many years, it worked tremendously well for us. It provided a steady and growing revenue source. But I think actually in three ways now, it's kind of come back to hurt us. First, having our own trust fund walled off from what was going on in the rest of the federal budget has actually let us off the hook in some ways from having to make the best economic and public policy case for our programs. It's let us off the hook sometimes from having to make tough decisions about the best projects and programs to invest in. You know, especially as was discussed in the panel, some of those less glamorous projects needed to maintain things in a state of good repair. Any of you who've spent time with Asian and European transportation experts know they engage in a lot of cases in much more rigorous analysis than we do here in the United States. I mean, we have many terrific transportation economists and experts, but we just don't have that same level of rigor and expertise throughout our transportation system as just a matter of general practice. At USDOT, we got to see that firsthand when we ran this very unique discretionary program called Tiger. We run it the past 2 years, and we're about to gear up and run it a third year. Instead of awarding funds in the traditional way that we do in Washington through formulas, we ran a competition, and we encouraged applicants to focus on project outcomes, to use cost-benefit analysis, and to leverage other public and private funds, as California has done so well. And California did very well in Tiger. I would just note California got over $170 million, which is, given the size of the program, way better than any other part of the country, including Doyle Drive right here in San Francisco and the East Bay Bicycle Network and Port of L.A., the Crenshaw Line down in L.A. So you've done very well here. But we discovered through Tiger that, unlike California, a lot of states and transportation agencies could not enumerate, even at a basic level, the costs and benefits or track outcomes for projects that were going to cost taxpayers tens of millions of dollars. This is, you know, turned out to be especially true, not surprisingly, in states that have relied upon what is now the endangered species in Washington earmarks. For those states moving to a more analytic and outcome-based model of selecting projects and finding those new sources of revenue beyond federal funds, as California has done, but as John Horsley mentioned, states, particularly more rural states, have really not been able to do, that's a huge challenge for a lot of state and transportation agencies. So that's, I think that's one drawback we've had in sort of our gas tax trust fund model. Secondly, at the federal level, our trust fund is a sea of complexities, and we alluded to some of them here. Some of the terms we use at the federal level for transportation: contract authority, obligation limits, outlays, revenue-aligned budget authority. It's made our program needlessly opaque, and it's very hard for the uninitiated to understand, including the general public, who really needs to understand what we're doing. I actually got to see Asha speak on another panel, and she was there with an expert from the Government Accountability Office, Susan Irving, who is an expert on trust funds and budgeting in general. And Susan actually said that compared to a lot of other countries, the U.S. has a needlessly complicated budgeting system that's very complex, lacks transparency, and in a lot of cases hides from policymakers and from the general public essentially the basic information about what we're taking in and what we're spending. So it's no wonder the public feels disconnected, particularly at the federal level, from what we're trying to do. I think this has turned out to be especially true with the federal gas tax. Almost no one in the country knows anything about it other than their belief that it's too high and it goes up every year, even though it hasn't gone up in quite a few years. They don't know what they're paying and they don't know what they get. Finally, our trust fund has enabled us to sort of, in transportation, remain a relatively insular discipline. We've been actually very slow to embrace a lot of the bigger reform trends that you see in a lot of other public policy areas: healthcare, education, housing, criminal justice. As a result, transportation has really lagged behind in some instances in keeping up with the nation's changing transportation priorities. I think that's less true in California, but you see that more in other parts of the country. Using, as we do, basically a mid-20th century funding source, the gas tax user fee, which we passed to build a brand new interstate system, in which I guess at the time we thought we would never have to repair or rehabilitate, that 20th century funding source has not served us so well in the 21st century. And we've talked a little bit about the gas tax increases and how difficult they are to do. A little bit of history on it. The gas tax has largely been used to build the interstate system. In 1982, we opened it up a little bit and let some of the funds be used for transit. In 1991, we opened it up a little bit more under the bill Steve mentioned, ICE-T, passed by Senator Moynihan. And we made it easier for bicycle and pedestrian projects to get in. But generally speaking, we haven't opened it up very much. And I was just doing a little homework looking at sort of what exactly is the history of gas tax increases, something that obsesses us all in Washington right now. Since 1956, we've basically really only raised the gas tax four times. It was 3 cents back in 1956, passed to start building the interstate. We raised it by a penny in 1959. We raised it up to 9 cents in 1982 when we started to fund a bit of mass transit. In 1986, we raised it just a tenth of a penny to clean up leaking underground storage tanks. In 1990, we went up to 14.1 cents. In 1993, we took it up to its current level, 18.4 cents. At first, though, we used the entire increase to reduce the deficit. And then several years later, we actually turned that money back to transportation. Could be a potential model for someone. But that turns out over 55 years, we've really only significantly managed to raise the gas tax four times. So we've done it about an average of every 14 years. And it's not an easy thing to do. I have now been in Washington for 15 years, and every year I see that the gas tax becomes more and more unpopular in the rhetoric of elected officials. You know, at the time that, frankly, the impact of the gas tax is felt less and less by the public. And, you know, as John mentioned, it's wonderful to look at the polling, but the dynamic in Washington right now is, I think with only two exceptions, every Republican in Congress has signed the Grover-Norquist no tax pledge. And that makes it, you know, even if in their heart of hearts they wanted to change their minds at some point, it's pretty difficult once you've signed a pledge like that to go back on it. I will just say one bit of wisdom from my former boss and your senator, Senator Boxer. She was one who very shrewdly always said, "I don't sign pledges." Because you never know what's coming. You don't know what's going to change in the country. And, you know, as an elected official, I have to be ready to make compromises and do what we need to do as times change. I think that was wise. Now, I think as John and Asha have mentioned, the story is a little more positive at the state level. There are ballot initiatives passing there. Gas taxes are going up. I think nonetheless, even at the state level, the backlog is growing and the unmet needs are growing. And in Washington, even as the funding debate is admittedly pretty much ground to a halt at the moment, I do think we're actually making some progress on the discussion of policy reform. And that's really been driven, some of the commissions, like the one Steve was on, have helped drive the debate. But it's also really been driven by the grassroots. It's been driven by what the American public wants. As all of us in DOT have traveled around the country, we've heard pretty clearly from people they want more transportation choices, they want affordable choices, they want more environmentally sustainable choices, they want transportation projects that are going to enhance their communities, that are going to enhance their quality of life. Everywhere we go, we hear that. And, you know, in Washington, sometimes the fight revolves around and around, are we fighting versus highways and transits and other things. I think what we hear from the American public is they want it all. They're going to keep their car, but they don't want to have to drive every minute of the day. They want to have choices. So as John mentioned, as part of President Obama's fiscal year 2012 budget, we did seek to address the demand we're hearing from the American public, and we put out, admittedly, a very big and bold reauthorization proposal with a lot of new reforms and new ideas. Price tag of $556 billion for 6 years, with big new investments in highways and transit, safety programs. We proposed an infrastructure bank, which I think California would do well in. Our own innovative version of Race to the Top, a transportation version, that we're hoping would spur some further reform at the state and metropolitan level. We also proposed, as everyone in California knows, $53 billion for our signature initiative, creating a high-speed rail system for America, led, of course, by California. You know, just as we've had the interstate system, high-speed rail is the type of generation, type of challenge that will take a generation or two to complete, one that I hope our generation will take up the mantle on, given that whether we want to admit it or not, our nation's population is projected to grow by 100 million people, which is an astonishing number. And as many of our roadways are, you know, completely clogged, as are our airports, we're going to have to find ways to move these people, and high-speed rail is going to have to be part of the solution. It can be fast, convenient, environmentally friendly. If we do it right, it'll put thousands of people to work and hopefully, you know, revitalize our domestic rail manufacturing sector. And, you know, this is incredibly important for California. Just as the country's population is going to grow by 100 million by 2050, California is going to be almost 60 million people by 2050. It's a little unimaginable. And your roadways and airports are basically at capacity. We were driving from SFO to San Francisco yesterday, so I can tell you that. It took us a long time to get here. I'm going to San Jose this afternoon. That's my excuse. Okay, next time I will, I promise. Our reauthorization proposal actually also focuses on some of the types of reforms that Steve mentioned. I actually think, Steve, that the reform discussion is the money discussion in Washington is not gelling, but the reform discussion actually is to some degree. And we've looked at things like consolidating the 100-plus federal programs that there are, improving project delivery, system preservation, creating a more integrated performance-based planning system, environmental sustainability, and a national freight policy, which is something that's really important here in California. And I would just say, in terms of our planning provision, we had a lot of help from another native daughter, Therese McMillan, who also comes from MTC and is now the Deputy Federal Transit Administrator. And she actually really helped write the planning section of our proposal, and I think took a lot of the great ways that you do things here in the Bay Area, and basically we're going national with it. And we have put some tools on the table to help with transportation finance. Something that we're proposing, which is a first, and which you've already been doing here, is finally a national tolling policy that will allow congestion pricing and cordon pricing and allow those revenues to be used, as you do in this area, for a whole variety of transportation solutions. We also will have an infrastructure bank, and we're proposing increasing the amount of private activity bonds. And there has been some progress on the legislative process in Washington, too. Again, we've put out a proposal, and your Senator Barbara Boxer, chair of the Environment Public Works Committee, I believe she's close to putting out a proposal sometime this summer, as is her House counterpart, John Mica. And I think, actually, all three proposals will have some common ground on the policy front. Again, things like program consolidation, performance, focusing on encouraging private investment and improving project delivery. But it is true, we are miles apart on funding. We've proposed a big, big, big bill, $556 billion. Chairman Boxer is looking at a bill in the area of $340 billion. And Chairman Mica right now is looking at just what the gas taxes could support, which I heard with great authority from John Horsley is $219 billion, which obviously would represent some pretty major cuts in the federal program. I think the truth is we've started to achieve consensus on what a 21st century vision of transportation policy should be. But I have to admit, we don't have a 21st century vision of how to pay for it, and we're clearly going to need both if we want to succeed. At the moment, you know, just like here in California, we are all consumed with our budgetary troubles and our debt ceiling debate. It has taken precedence over almost everything else, including the transportation funding debate. And there has been, just as I think you're struggling with here, an incredible political unwillingness to tackle the revenue side of our fiscal situation. It's not just on the transportation side. We tend to think of our problems as being only ours, but we're part of a much bigger and difficult discussion that's happening in Washington. And probably some of you saw, I think the day before yesterday, we'd been having weeks, the vice president had been having weeks of discussions with the leadership in Congress, particularly the Republican leadership, and the talks just blew up. And people have stomped away with the accusation that the Obama administration will not give up on wanting to have a balance of spending cuts and some revenue increases. Does that sound familiar to you all here in California? I'm sure at some time the parties will come back together again. Usually in Washington there is a lot of drama when we're getting close to making tough decisions. And like you are here in California, as Steve said, we're having to finally come around to trying to grapple with what it means to have to live within our means. Right now at the federal level, we borrow over 40 cents on every dollar that we spend. And clearly that is unsustainable. But as far as transportation is concerned, we are not alone. We're part of the bigger mix of programs that are experiencing cuts. It could be housing, could be education, could be environmental enforcement. But I'm not sure that's all entirely bad for transportation. It actually might get us to do a few things a little better. It'll require us in our field probably to get more serious about economic analysis, to really ensure that every public dollar is being spent as well as it can and that we're making the case to the public. It will also require us to do things a lot more efficiently on both the public and the private side. A lot of other fields and industries have achieved a lot more in efficiency gains than we have in the transportation sector. It will require a lot of innovation and new creative ways of doing our operations and our project delivery, and it'll require, I think something, again, where you're a leader in the Bay Area, more pricing and technology to make use of our existing capacity. You know, one of the biggest things we talk about in transportation is the largest amount of unused capacity we have is all the cars driving around that have just one person in them. If there's any way to make better use of that capacity, it's free capacity just sitting there, and with some ingenuity, we could probably make better use of it. And it will require us in the transportation field to articulate, I think, a more compelling set of transportation goals and then prioritize our investments and policies to meet those goals. Those are things, I think, that the American public cares deeply about. OSHA's poll looked at what types of things people are willing to raise gas taxes to pay for. When I ran Building America's Future, we also did some polling, and we actually sort of looked at a different set of questions. We discovered that we asked sort of a different set of questions about, if we were going to raise the gas tax, how would you want to make sure the money was spent? And the answers that we got is people were willing to raise the gas tax if they felt like we were going to spend the money in an accountable and transparent way for projects that were selected by merit, not boondoggles and earmarks, to achieve clearly articulated goals. And I think the good news is we can do that right now before we resolve the funding debate in Washington. And in DOT, that's something we are trying to do right now. So although none of us, I think, can predict at the moment what's going to happen in Washington and when we will actually achieve consensus on the transportation proposals, we do have an advantage in our field. It has traditionally been bipartisan in a way that a lot of other things in Washington haven't. I was in Washington for 10 years, a legislative director, so I got to work on every issue under the sun, from abortion to gun control to energy policy to farm subsidies, and I think transportation truly is the issue that is the most bipartisan. It's one of the reasons I like it so much, because it is an issue that has traditionally brought people together from different parties in different parts of the country. So I think if we can do a better job in transportation in reforming our field and demonstrating to the American public that we have real value, that we're an important part of their daily lives, maybe our political leaders in Washington will come together and address our infrastructure needs. Senator Moynihan, my first boss on Capitol Hill, who taught me a lot about transportation and American government and history, loved to say that things like urban planning and politics were not for the short-winded. And I like to keep his wise words in mind at DOT as I do my job, and you know, we try in every way that we can, hopefully, to bring about a new generation of investment in transportation. So thank you very much.
So we thank Polly Trottenberg, our Assistant Secretary for Transportation Policy at USDOT, for her presentation. I'm Mort Downey, a chair of the Mineta Transportation Institute Board of Trustees and a former Deputy Secretary at DOT, but I am your moderator for today's audience question period, and I have many, many questions here, so let's get on with them. In your comments, you made the point of the gap that exists between our existing revenues and what the administration has identified as the needs, but can you just confirm that in terms of that number range? A couple of people have asked specificity.
Yeah, I mean, because future gas tax revenue estimates jump around a little bit, I think I will characterize it as being north of $200 billion, so it is a big number, there's no question. You know, we have, again, I think we've had an easier time articulating the kinds of investments we want to make and the level we think we want to invest in versus how we're actually going to pay for it all, no question about it.
But the understanding is that eventually, if there is a proposal, it will be paid for.
Well, yes. I mean, I think you know, as you heard some of the panelists say today, we are currently using a lot of general taxpayer funds to pay for transportation. And you know, I think there's actually a little bit of a debate about whether that's a terrible idea or not. I mean, it's interesting. Steve said we want to keep the user pays principle. But the user pays principle will not fund high-speed rail. And the user pays principle has not, I think, actually made nearly the investments we need in our transit systems. So there's not only sort of the existential question about whether or not we could ever raise the gas tax, but even if we could, politically, those funds which people perceive to be highway user funds, could we ever spend them politically on the broad range of transportation investments that I think we all agree we need to make?
We have a number of questions and suggestions about specific ways to raise new funds. I'm going to ask you about them, and then I'm going to expect you to say you had no comment. But I would do the same if I were in your shoes, but there is a lot of thought about how can we convince the public that it would be in their interest to raise revenues, or should we consider taxing at the oil company level rather than at the pump? Should we be using our tax policy as part of energy policy with a mix of taxes on various sources, or should we also be looking at license fees and other not direct use revenue measures, but other activities? So I know you think about all of those, but I'm not going to be surprised if you say you haven't got one here today to roll out.
Well, I mean, I will say this, and those are very good questions. I mean, it's funny, we were joking about how in Washington we're not quite in real America, and I think that's right. And it's refreshing when I travel around the country to hear people having some very practical ideas about, well, here are some ways we could raise revenue. We could raise the gas tax or oil fees or whatever it is. And there are a lot of great ideas on the table. I mean, the truth is, in Washington right now, we are not yet at the place where we've achieved a consensus on any of it. And so obviously, I think as Mort is right, I'm not going to say, yes, we like this idea or that idea. I think as you sort of, look at the history of the gas tax when we have raised it in the United States, it's sometimes been in conjunction with achieving other goals. And it may be that that's what will happen in this go-around, that it'll be part of a global solution where perhaps we're looking at reducing the deficit, we're looking at a package of maybe some revenue raisers, maybe in some places some revenue decreases. I think, again, it's probably not just going to be the one thing that's going to save us in transportation. It'll be part of, I think, a pretty big re-envisioning of how we do revenue in the United States. And, you know, you're hearing rumblings of that in Washington right now. I mean, for many, many years on Capitol Hill, I worked on the issue of ethanol subsidies, and it was one of the toughest fights I've ever been involved in. And, you know, for the first time, the U.S. Senate voted to get rid of them overwhelmingly. That's a remarkable change in our politics. And despite worrying about the paralysis in Washington, it does show that at the same time, people are willing to challenge some things that have been pretty conventional wisdom in American politics. So I'm not quite sure where that's going to go. But I think our mission at DOT is to try and make sure that transportation gets in on the ride.
By the way, the good news about getting rid of ethanol is that gasoline will then become more efficient to burn and we'll use less of it and generate more less revenues into the Highway Trust Fund. So no good deed goes unpunished. We had a lot of conversation on the earlier panel about how we make choices in our transportation investment, how do we have accountability for results, how do we look to the long term as well as the short term. In your thinking in the department, how are you addressing that?
Yeah, that's a great question, and it's, I think, one of the areas where, compared to some of the other domestic policy areas, transportation has really lagged. I think in education and criminal justice and other areas, they've been thinking about this issue much longer than we have and doing a better job of trying to track results and outcomes and make adjustments as needed. Because we've relied for so long on, you know, in many ways just a system of formula grants, that hasn't induced states to actually kind of take a hard look at how they're investing their funds sometimes and track the outcomes and make sure that what they predict their projects were going to do is what their projects actually do. Because we've gotten to run this discretionary grant program, Tiger, we got to engage in a lot of experimentation around it. And one of the things that we were able to do is, with any project that we're giving our dollars to, they have to sign a grant agreement with them, and we got them to agree that they would start gathering data and tracking some of the outcomes, and that we would see at the end of the process whether the projects had delivered the things that they said they were going to deliver. It's proved an extraordinarily difficult process to get off the ground. A lot of places aren't used to tracking ridership, let alone things like air quality benefits and economic benefits. And, you know, I think this is an experiment that we've started with Tiger. If you look at our reauthorization proposal, we're proposing to do it much more throughout the entire transportation system. And I think some areas, again, like the Bay Area, is probably leading the country on in this area, but it's an area we definitely need to go to. And I have to give credit to APTA and ASHTO, two of the big transportation organizations in Washington that have really been helping to push their members to become better at this, particularly as resources are shrinking. We have no choice.
Successful transportation efforts at the local level have really emphasized what is going to be delivered, and we've got some extraordinary victories to point to. The referendum in this state that supported high-speed rail, very strong statewide majority, similar measures at the local level. But I'm getting the feeling from some of the comments this morning that, again, this is local initiative that's not being necessarily rewarded. And how do you think about both the idea of what do we sell, what do we do on our own regard, and then what does the federal government come in to do to encourage both the good projects and those that are providing self-help?
Yeah, and I think it's important, as John mentioned, to distinguish, you know, the United States is a big place, and California is always going to be at one end, and a place like North Dakota is going to be at another end. And you, I have grown in my time in the federal government cautious about one size fits all. Some places are going to have to, by necessity, produce a lot more resources because they have to do a lot more for their citizens. California would be one of them. Sorry, let me just get a drink of water here. But moving forward, we are going to have to try and encourage all states and localities and transit agencies to do more self-help. And again, through Tiger and High Speed Rail, two small discretionary programs that the Department of Transportation got to run, we got to do that for the first time. You know, it's very, very different to say, here's State of California, here's your formula funds, just make sure that you meet all our bureaucratic requirements, versus, hey, State of California, we've got $8 billion in high-speed rail funds. Come and compete and show us why you have the best project and show us how much money you're willing to bring to the table. You get a tremendously different result when you're able to do that. You can't do that for the entire transportation program, and I think we would all agree you need some regular federal funds, because states and transit agencies, they need some certainty. They need to know year in and year out that they're getting a certain amount of money that they don't have to compete for, because if you have to compete, you might get the money and you might not. But I think we think going forward that competition is got to be at least a piece of what we do in transportation. And the one of the things we have in our proposal we mentioned is a transportation race to the top type concept. A little bit different than what the Department of Education did. I think we're hoping it would be something that would have a lot more geographic distribution to it. But one of the things that we would richly reward, and that would be exactly that. States and localities that engage in self-help. There are parts of the country, states, that will not allow their counties and cities to raise their own taxes. There are parts of the country where gas taxes can still only be spent on highways, even if the state is starting to have other needs like transit. So there are all kinds of ways that we could potentially incentivize that. I will say that that is just politically in Washington probably one of the most controversial things we are proposing, though. It's interesting. You know, the more conservative members of Congress have a real skepticism about DOT's discretionary programs. They have a skepticism in general about them, and they feel very strongly that Congress controls the purse strings, and Congress should choose the projects, and letting the administration do it is a bad idea. So I think that's what we'd like to do. I think that that will definitely be a tough political fight, which is a pity, because I think if you look at things like Tiger, where we were able to leverage incredible amounts of private investment, it's exactly the kind of program that I actually think conservatives should like, but they have a skepticism about it.
Another thing that there's some skepticism about, well, I think in this region, in this room, it probably resonates, is the administration's views on livability, pedestrian and bike use, and the like. Interested in your reaction to that. We also have a very specific question. It says, for years, decades, we've measured the effectiveness of the highway program and the degree of quality of pavement. Are we thinking about measures that would actually allow a measurement of our quality of life vis-a-vis walkability, pedestrian use, and the like?
Yeah, those are very good questions. It is true that as we've traveled the country, as I said before, the concept of livability was not actually one that we dreamed up at USDOT. It is one that came to us as we talked to people around the country, and obviously people in areas like this are particularly big supporters of it. It's not the radical concept that people, I think, sometimes think it is. It is the notion that we ought to have a balanced transportation system, that we ought to give people choices. They can drive their car, they can take the train, they can walk places. I mean, you know, in many, many parts of the country, it is very difficult to walk anywhere. And that's had some profound results, growing childhood obesity being a big one. And what's funny is at DOT, we've become, particularly Secretary LaHood, much to a lot of people's surprise, has become very well known as a huge bicycle advocate. I think people were thinking that a Republican congressman from Peoria was not going to be a big bicycle advocate, but he is. And, you know, we often get a lot of hostility.
And he was before he took this job.
Yes, we get a lot of hostility about it sometimes. And it's interesting. I will sometimes say to people, so let's talk about bikes. We have a mode of transportation which is extraordinarily inexpensive, that doesn't consume fuel or produce greenhouse gases, that helps people get in shape, helps tackle the obesity problem we're facing in the country, that lets people better connect with their communities, because when you're biking through your community, you're just going to be more connected to it, and is a lot of fun. What's wrong with that? And usually when I put it that way, people say, yeah, that's true. So I think that's sort of the concept of livability. It's giving people more choices. It's trying to integrate our transportation systems better into our communities. It is not a radical idea. It is something we see an interest in all over the country. I got to travel last year to Bismarck, North Dakota, and they asked us about it, and they were very skeptical about it at first. You know, what is this livability thing? Sounds like some coastal plot. And from the Californians and the New Yorkers. And, you know, we talked about what the challenges were that are facing that part of the country. One is, you know, they're having a drain of their young people. A lot of the young people are leaving the plain states, and a lot of their downtowns are, you know, emptying out. So one thing we talked about with livability is, well, wouldn't it be nice to get people walking and biking around the downtowns again, to bring a little vitality back to them? Another issue they have in that part of the country is the population's aging, and people can be tremendously isolated. Interestingly enough, in urban centers, older Americans often have a lot more choices, paratransit, and they can get to destinations much more easily. In the Dakotas and out in the Plain States, when you get too old to drive, you can be very, very isolated. And so another thing we talked about is providing transportation services for those folks. And when we put it in those terms, people were very, very enthusiastic about it. So I think it's not a radical concept. It's making the transportation system that we have work for all Americans. And again, we didn't dream it up. We hear it from people all over the country, and not just from the usual suspects, from North Dakota and Atlanta and you name it. Now, on the question of measures, That's one I think you're interested in too, Mort, because I think Mort suggested that USDOT needed to come up with a measure for quality of life. We have been looking a lot at measures. It is not an easy thing to do. I mean, one thing that's interesting, a lot of the transportation models are very, very good at looking at automobile trips of a certain length. They are not so good at looking at walking and biking and other things. The new data collection that we have out there through GPSs is starting to change that. And here in San Francisco, actually, the city used it to really get a very good survey of how much people are biking. So we will be starting to, I think, through new technology, collect better data just on how people actually move. Getting into the more, I think, difficult questions to answer about how much economic vitality have you created, you can look at real estate values and things like that, and we've been doing some of that. We've also been looking at a measure that looks at one issue we often have on the housing side is when underwriters are considering granting a mortgage, they look at only your housing cost, they don't consider your transportation cost. And right now in the United States, transportation is the second highest cost for most households, and particularly for low-income families, it's sometimes the highest cost. So we're also trying to look at, are there better ways we can look at some kind of a measure of those combined costs. I think in terms of how does transportation improve happiness and improve quality of life, I don't know if we've quite figured that one out yet, but we're going to keep working on it.
Is it the Mongolians or the Tibetans? One or the other has now tried to measure
It's the Bhutanese.
Right.
Bhutan.
Yeah. Right. Measure of.
And they're a very happy country,
happiness.
I think,
right.
is what they.
Yeah.
They
Bhutan.
Have.
Right. That's it.
We were not so happy,
happy
as it turned out.
Happy campers there. Yeah. Right. In that effort on livability and community development and the like, can you describe the relationships you're developing with other agencies, with other programs? Because I think it is an integration of a lot of different approaches that would make for success.
Yeah, when the Obama administration got started, one of the first things that we did at USDOT was form a partnership with HUD, Housing and Urban Development, and Environmental Protection Agency. And I think you would sit back and certainly probably in the Bay Area and say, well, doing your transportation, housing, environmental, and economic planning together, that seems pretty logical. And yet at the federal level, we don't do it at all. And this has proved groundbreaking, exciting, and incredibly difficult to do. And I'll just give you a, sort of a tiny example that gives you a sense of the challenges. So in this TIGER program, for the last go-around, we had between DOT and HUD combined about $75 million in planning grants to award, which in the big picture of the federal government, $75 million, not a huge amount of money. And the two agencies, we actually have an advantage in Washington. The Congressional Appropriations Subcommittee that oversees our funding is the same committee for both agencies. It's called THUD, Transportation, Housing, Urban Development. So the same staff oversees the budget of both agencies. So we propose to combine this grand total of $75 million and do joint planning grant awards so that we could reward areas that actually were trying to think about housing, job creation, and transportation holistically. Our overseers on Capitol Hill were livid at us. They screamed at us. They could not get over that we were doing this crazy, outrageous thing. And when we sort of sat with them at one point and said, but doesn't it make sense to do housing and transportation planning together? Their answer was, well, yes, it does, of course, but, and then went at us again. Because this was just, it was a trend, it's a change, it's a new way of doing things. And, you know, that takes time. And as the two agencies actually went forward and did the planning grants together, we discovered the congressional requirements, the Office of Management and Budget requirements, our legal schemes, our grant-making authorities, everything about the two agencies was radically different. And every step of the way, it took us weeks and weeks and weeks. We had different computer systems, you name it. So every step of the way, it took us weeks and weeks and weeks to untangle it and work together. But in the end, we succeeded in doing it. The staffs from both agencies, as well as EPA, jointly evaluated all the planning grants, and we picked fantastic grants all over the country. We did one here, actually, in Oakland to redevelop the old Army base area. So we got wonderful projects out of it, and it was well worth the effort. But it's a long and difficult effort, and yet it's crazy that it's taken this long.
And will you be telling telling people what the results have been and how things have come yes, to pass because of this joint
plan. We actually just had a 2-year anniversary celebration in which we went through all our accomplishments, and there is now a website, which I don't remember off the top of my head, but I think if you type in Sustainable Communities DOT, it will pop up. I think the planning grants is one of the biggest tangible products we've had. We are also working on sort of a list of what we would consider to be the barriers to basically letting states and communities access our dollars and our expertise to do holistic planning and holistic infrastructure investment. The list is very long, and we're determined to work our way through it as best we can.
Great. Let me remind our radio audience that you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program. Today we're discussing the financing of U.S. road and transit systems and infrastructure investment with Polly Trottenberg. Polly is the Assistant Secretary for Transportation Policy at the U.S. Department of Transportation, and this program is co-sponsored by the Commonwealth Club and the Mineta Transportation Institute. Let's turn to high-speed rail and intercity rail. Obviously, a lot of interest here, but a lot of interest other places. Do you want to give us your thoughts on where California is going and what you're doing to help them get this system going?
As I said in my remarks, California is once again the leader. This state has been out way ahead of the rest of the country, and by necessity. I mean, if any state can do it, I think it's California. You have the ingenuity and the population and the resources needed to pull this off. And I think USDOT, we have been incredibly excited to be such a big partner with the state. As some of you may know, we've put over $4 billion into California high-speed rail, including that $400 million hole there at Transbay, which we got to see yesterday. That is going to be one heck of a station when it's done. Wow.
Yeah.
Grand Central Station of the West. Grand Central Station doesn't have the green roof and all that stuff, though.
This is California.
Yeah. I know. It's fantastic. And I think, as some of you may know, a lot of the DOT leadership has been very personally involved in, you know, coming out to California and trying to help to make sure that this project does succeed. I mean, it is a signature issue for President Obama and for the administration, and, you know, a serious undertaking for our country, and one that is going to take a generation, and no doubt, just like the interstate system itself, there will be a lot of ups and downs before we get there. But, I mean, here we are today talking about what the Chinese are doing and the Europeans, and we have got to catch up. I mean, we are a vastly growing country, and we are not going to be able to keep building roadways and runways. We are going to have to find another way to go, and high-speed rail is, you know, proven and successful all over the world. Because we are uniquely American in our governance structure, if you go to Europe, or certainly if you go to Asia, you generally there have more centralized national governments, and frankly, that makes it a lot easier to do high-speed rail, when the central government can just say, here's what we're going to do, and here's what we're going to put it, and here's how we're going to pay for it. Because we are a big and decentralized country, we started our high-speed rail process a little bit backwards, back with the passage of the PREA bill in Washington, the passenger rail infrastructure bill. We basically told the 50 states to go and come up with their own rail plans, and we were looking at the 50 states to come up with a lot of the money, too. Once we passed the Recovery Act, we got some federal dollars on the table, and it has become really a partnership between the federal government and the states. And in some ways, that's more cumbersome than what the Chinese or the French get to do, but I also think that's the formula that's going to work for the United States. It's going to work particularly well in California. You're blessed. You're one state. We are also doing a lot of work with the Northeast Corridor. That's 12 states. And trying to get 12 states to all agree on how to move forward on funding, on environmental questions, incredibly challenging. You do have the advantage here of your one unified state, and it's part of why I think you're going to be, well, all right,
or one
unified,
state.
Unified may be overstating it, but relatively speaking, compared to the 12 states of the Northeast Corridor, that's a huge advantage for you. Don't underestimate it. As difficult as things may be in Sacramento, and I know there's huge debates here about the project and whether it's starting in the right place and how's it going to work on the peninsula, and you obviously will have to work through all those issues. Look, as they did with the interstates, and they made some mistakes with the interstates, no question about it. But I think California can do it, and that's why we're so excited at DOT to be a partner in that and to help in any way that we can. Again, it's going to be a partnership, so the state's going to have to come up with a lot of the money, and we're going to have to come up with some too. And at the moment, as we've been discussing all morning, How and when that's going to happen is, I think, still a question mark, but it remains a huge priority for us, and I'm confident that we will be getting more federal funding for high-speed rail in the coming years.
And in your thinking about rail, is a broad spectrum of improvements that might occur. It isn't all California-style high-speed rail. It isn't all other types, but you're open to, I hope, suggestions as to how to best start and then improve levels of service different corridors.
And in fact, we basically, I mean, it's funny, when we in the United States got into the high-speed rail business, a lot of us still had a big learning curve in understanding that true high-speed rail, like what you want to do in a lot of California, dedicated tracks, 200 miles an hour, that's expensive premium service, and you need a big population, and you need a big economic activity to justify that kind of service. There are a lot of parts of the country where that's never going to make sense financially, but there are lots of parts of the country where we can make a lot of improvements in the existing rail systems. In some places where the train is running three times a week and toodles along at 50 miles an hour, if you could get it running every day and going 75 miles an hour, that would make a tremendous difference. And, you know, when you visit other countries, they are not so focused as we are on, does the train run 200 miles an hour? They're focused on how much time does it take to get between city pairs. That's really the question, and that's the question you all are going to try and solve here. Making, you know, train travel competitive between your major cities in California is going to have tremendous unlocking of economic potential. You can do that at different parts of the country at different price tags. In the Midwest, in a lot of places, for pretty modest investments, you can bring the cities that circle around Chicago together for very reasonable trip times.
Yeah, even China, we're looking at what they're up to. Very interesting. They're now slowing down their high speed a little bit for a number of reasons, but also when they've discovered that the quality of the service is good enough to get a large number of people, but to get some more people to ride, the fare ought to be a little lower, and the way to do that is to take the speed. So it's a very sensitive set of issues, but the goal really is moving people from place to place, not the particular technology.
Not to achieve a particular speed.
Yeah, right. How about on the East Coast? There's been some discussion in the last week or two about new proposals for Amtrak and the Northeast Corridor and how those 12 states and the federal government might come together. Has the administration given any thought to those ideas?
We have indeed, and as you know, we have a couple of members of DOT who are on the congressionally created Northeast Corridor Commission. We are, just as we are very involved in California, we are also very involved there in the effort to try and pull those states together. As you saw from the bill that Chairman Mica has announced, and he has always had a long-standing interest in improving rail in the high-speed corridor, and rightly so. It is, in addition to California, the other part of the country where you can make a clear case for high-speed rail at fast speeds, going quickly between major urban centers, where people will pay for the tickets. And, you know, it's been a long and difficult struggle to figure out how to pull those states together and working with Amtrak improve the rail service there. We, as some of you know, some states have chosen to turn their high-speed rail money back. Florida was one of those. And I know California was hoping to get it all, but we did give some to some other parts of the country, including close to $1 billion to the Northeast Corridor, really hopefully to jumpstart the efforts there. And the good news there is the investments that you make pay off right away. There is speaking of another part of the country where there is a tremendous backlog, you know, as much as people complain about what we spent on Amtrak, the truth is we've really starved Amtrak, and there's been a lot of disinvestment in the Northeast Corridor. And you know this very well, Mort.
Sat on their board as we were
exactly.
starving them.
Exactly. You sat on the board as they were starving them. And I was on Capitol Hill as we were starving them, and we all knew we were starving them, and it was a big mistake. And now we're trying to catch up and make some of those needed investments. And they'll be useful now for people riding in the Northeast Corridor, but the ultimate goal there, and I think we share the goal with Chairman Mica. I'm not sure we agree on how to get there, but, you know, that is a part of the country that also should have incredible high-speed service moving people between cities, you know, in a couple of hours.
Shifting gears, we're in a part of the country where innovation, technology, research, education are very strong components of their thinking. How is DOT in its forward-looking approach to things trying to grab onto new innovations, research in social science? We heard some good research this morning about finance. What's your thinking about that for the future?
Yeah, that's a good question. And I think one of the hallmarks in general of the Obama administration is they are very focused on, they call themselves data-driven and looking at research and innovation. And we have a whole handful of innovation and technology councils that a lot of us participate in. You know, particularly Peter Appel, who's our administrator of our Research and Innovative Technology Administration. And we look at all kinds of research, social research, technological research, you name it. You know, one thing we are trying to do, we've been speaking about how we're trying to shift from a paradigm of formula funds to going more competitive. One of the sort of the weak spots in the way we do transportation research at the federal level, you know this, Mort, is a lot of the university transportation centers were earmarked. I've been on both sides of that equation, having worked in Congress and maybe helped get an earmark or two.
Yeah,
maybe I helped get a couple. But if you think about it, talk about a way to not get the best bang for your buck for your research dollar, to just earmark. And look, some universities rise to the challenge, but I think, unfortunately, some of them, they may get $1 million a year, and we get nothing for it. And that's just crazy. I mean, I don't think that's happening. I don't think our economic competitors are being that lax. So one of the things we're trying to do is transition to a competitive model on research, and we think we will, and technology, and I think we will get a lot more cutting edge and mind-blowing research when folks have to compete for it. We are also on the technological question focused on, it's sort of a perennial debate about looking for the newest technologies and better deploying the ones we already have. I mean, here in California, you have a lot of ramp metering, for example, which, you know, has proven to be extraordinarily cost-effective. Most parts of the country won't touch it. We'd better utilize their capacity. It helps traffic flow. It's very inexpensive. It's a proven technology. It has many, many things in its favor. So although we are trying to focus on what the latest cutting-edge technologies are, some of us are also focused on the question of how can we better use the ones we've already figured out that are really inexpensive and make a lot of sense.
Let me change gears again to the issue of goods movement and freight and how it relates to economic growth, and wondering where your thinking is with respect to our ports, to our connections to those ports, to our readiness to adapt when the Panama Canal opens, and particularly the President's goal of doubling exports and how we'll support that. Is goods movement alive and well at DOT?
It is very alive and well. And I think the President's export initiative, California, is a place that will clearly benefit from that. I've talked a lot about the Tiger discretionary program. One of the other surprising things is when we went into the program, we asked for applications from all over the country, any type of project, any mode. We didn't just ask for them from states. We let communities and you name it apply. In the end, we wound up giving over half the money to freight projects. And there's a reason for that. When we looked at the economic analysis, the projects scored off the charts. It's a real area of low-hanging fruit, because it's an area where the federal government has actually underinvested compared to a lot of our economic competitors. And so we are huge boosters on the freight side. We made huge freight rail investments. We did a couple here in California, the Port of LA, and then up the ports of, I think it's Stockton, West Sacramento, and Oakland. We have proposed in our reauthorization proposal to create a freight policy office, to put together a national freight policy, and to help use that to try and target investments in the future. You know, we're talking about the ways that the Chinese and other countries are outrunning us on high-speed rail. They're doing it on goods movement as well. There are a lot of other countries out there, even just the Canadians, that have really coherent national policies where they're looking at infrastructure, they're looking at their border policies, they're looking at all kinds of things, and we definitely need to catch up on that front.
We only have a couple of minutes left, but I would not want to finish a conversation without talking about safety. Really a primary goal, primary responsibility. Where are you headed in that direction? And specifically, someone would like to know what you're doing vis-a-vis motorcycles and the issues of motorcyclists and their contribution to our safety problems.
Well, that is a good question. And I think, you know, I would have to say here, one of the other reasons that we all love working for Secretary LaHood, he has really become, I think, a national champion and spokesman on safety in a way that is really groundbreaking. You know, his particular crusade, one of them has been on distracted driving, and, you know, I think that is an issue that has really caught on. I have to say, in Washington, it has changed the culture of everyone just being like this and not thinking about it to realizing, wow, this we're really a menace behind the wheel when we do this. We have in Washington the highest per capita cell phone usage rate in the country. But he's also been a champion in a lot of other areas. You know, as you know, transit safety is an area in Washington. You know, we just we're close to the anniversary of a terrible crash in our metro system, and since then we've really taken up the cause of having more federal oversight on transit safety. Right now, commuter rail has a safety regime, but regular old passenger transit rail doesn't, and it doesn't make sense. We've also been looking a lot at roadway safety, which gets into the question of motorcycles and other things. The truth is, in Washington right now, I think as a lot of you know, we've lost ground on things like helmet usage. Some states have actually gotten rid of their helmet laws. And one of the things we thought we would do again with the race to the top type program that we're proposing is, rather than mandate it, because I think the political appetite these days just isn't there for that, to at least incentivize it, to say to states, if you're willing to do some of these things, pass distracted driving laws, pass helmet laws, do the things you need to do, we'll reward you with federal dollars. It's probably the most successful way I think we're going to tackle some of those tougher safety issues.